first experience was I went to the Keystone in San Francisco, and I heard him live there up close and personal. I sat right in front of the bass drum, and it was so incredibly powerful. It changed how I play to this day. You know what I mean? It just affected me totally. Everything about it, the feel, was so nasty and funky and greasy, I couldn't believe it. I didn't even know what kind of ride beat he was playing. I mean, it didn't sound like Sam Woodyard or all the guys that I grew up on. You know, I was like, what's he doing? And then, you know, all of those roles that he played all over the place, all throughout, just his language, where he'd start and where he'd stop and what he was hearing was so radically different from anything that I'd ever heard. Even though, you know, first on records, but then hearing him do it live with all that power behind it was amazing. One night when I was with Herbie Hancock, this is even, was even more of a profound effect. I walked into the Smiling Dog in Cleveland. I think the Smiling Dog was in Cleveland. And it was a bar, a club that we all used to play, and I was in Herbie's band. And when I walked in, we got there a night early, and Hancock said, let's go down and hear Elvin Jones tonight. He's closing. This is their last night. And this was the band with Gene Perla and Grossman and Liebman. So when we walked in, Hancock went to say something to Elvin, and I was young, and I was scared to death to talk to him because he was a huge hero. It'd be like meeting a movie star. I just couldn't believe it, you know. And Herbie came over and said, Jones wants to talk to you at the bar. That's just what he said. And I'm like, Elvin Jones? So I went over there, introduced myself, and he asked me right away, do you want a drink? And I went, yeah, I like to drink, you know. So we had quite a few drinks. And he seemed so personable and easy to talk to. But I asked him a billion questions about playing with John Coltrane. And he answered them all. And he seemed to want to talk about it. He didn't seem bothered. We kept drinking. And then they hadn't played yet. And he said to me, he grabbed me quite strong and said, come up and sit next to the hi-hat behind the curtain. I'm going to show you how I did it with John. That was in the quote. That's exactly what he said to me. And so I went up and I sat there. And they had nailed in the spikes of his Gretsch drum set. The spurs were nailed down. There was three or four or five, whatever, nails to hold them in place. And he hit so hard at this point in his life. He hit so hard that I could feel it reverberating through my body. It was frightening. He hit so hard. It was like thunder. It was unbelievable. And the bass drum was standing up. I don't know if you can see my hand like this. He'd hit it, and it was bending. The nails were holding the spurs down, and he bent the spurs in the bass drum that night, hitting it so hard. He was playing shots all throughout the set that I'd never heard or seen him do before, like some different type of Elvin drumming that I had never associated with him. He made some moves around the set that I had that were like, he had zero respect for that reach between the mounted tom and the floor tom. And he put together some things that were astounding at a velocity that you could have played with a rock band that had 10 Marshalls stacked up there. You know, I mean, it was unbelievable how much. It was almost like he was transporting you into another dimension. He played so furious, and he brought the spirit up so high. And he was also a really nice guy, and he was funny as hell. He said a lot of great stuff, and he had a great sense of humor. Man, I've never heard anybody play like that, and it was heavy. And Herbie came over and joined me and sat down, and we were both had our just jaws on the floor. We were just astounded and stunned. I'm originally from the West Coast, and now I've been on the East Coast 30 years, and I've heard a lot of guys play at a very loud or strong or this or that, but being a West Coast guy, I'd never heard anybody hit that hard for that period of time when there was no electric instrument involved. And it was a life-changing experience, you know. Not to mention, afterwards, we drank for quite a while at the end of the night, and he drove me to my hotel. And he somehow produced or ran into a Camaro, and he drove about 95 miles an hour right down the main street and skidded, like in a movie, into the hotel. He was staying in this hotel. There was an old hotel with a circular driveway, and he opened the door. He skidded in and opened the door real fast, and then said, "Get out," and called me a name, affectionately. But we had a great time. We laughed and talked. We talked about other things besides drumming and jazz and all this. But he told me a lot of information. He said it was like as much fun as playing with a barrel of monkeys, because something was coming at you all the time, every second, and you had to react constantly. And he said it was completely fun and a joyful experience for him. And he loved John Coltrane, and that's what he told me. Quote, that's a quote. I asked him, did people complain because you were playing so loud? And he said, it took that much velocity to get the truth out when you played with John Coltrane. I asked him about swinging, and he said, I asked him about his ride beat, and he didn't give up. He was nice, and he was just like, well, that's just how I feel it. There was no information to inform you of how you got to that conclusion or any of that. You know what I mean? It was just, that's how I feel it. And I'm like, well, I hear you. He said he didn't particularly want to be a one-arm drummer. That's the way he said it. He wanted to play his ideas. He also said in the early days when he was formulating this style, when it was first coming together, he wasn't quite sure of where he was going, but this was what he was hearing, and it just kept getting better over the years. I think that's what he said. I know he said there was an early part, the formative time, and I'd heard some records with Pepper Adams and a few guys reflecting that, and then it just, you know, all that experience he had playing, he at one point, whatever that was, it just all came together. And look at the family he came from. I mean, you know, please, you know. He had two mounted tom-toms. Well, when I saw him at the Smiling Dog that time, he only had one. Later on, he had two mounted tom-toms on that yellow kit that he played. One floor tom, snare drum. He had a ride cymbal, usually a 20, I think, the primary ride, and then another cymbal over to the right of the floor tom, and then a crash cymbal that he could also ride on his left. And sometimes he'd have a 22. His wife sold a bunch of his cymbals to Don Bennett up in Seattle, and I played, there were 35 cymbals, and I played them all. And interestingly enough, they were all K's Zildjians, and all old K's Zildjians, or maybe a few new ones, I don't know exactly, I can't remember exactly, but majority of them were old K's, like the kind I used to have. And many of them were broke, right on the right-hand side, split away from the bell, but they still sounded really good. And a lot of them didn't sound so good. I don't think he was so particular about a cymbal. If he found something in the ballpark, then he made it work for him. His ride beat was so different than anybody else's I've ever heard, and it swung so hard, and it just had the maximum pocket and groove. And his orchestrations, those tripletized orchestrations, I've never heard anybody do that before. You know, I'd heard Roy Haynes play some triplets, you know, with the left hand against the right or whatever you want to say, and some, you know, but all of those sixes and all of those things that Elvin played, the two notes with the bass drum and then a six-stroke roll of some type of sticking or another, or more than six. I mean, he could carry on as long as he wanted, I'm sure. and did. But I'd never heard that before. I'd never heard anybody do that before. And he just seemed to be the type of genius musician that this just poured out of him. You know, I don't know where he got it. I know he was a marching. He was had some experience with marching drumming, and you can hear that at times, and watch by his hand movement as well that he had a training there.